Hello, I'm Karen, and today I'm going to share with you, this is my caveman bikini top. And the reason why I've made myself a caveman bikini top is because, as you know, I haven't made any videos for a little while, and that's because I was actually poorly. I picked up some kind of strange illness, so I decided that what I would do is that I would sit and I would try and work out my history in peace with no distractions, and I crocheted myself this bikini top. The reason it's got ties for you to do at the back and at the top, and I noticed that when I actually tied it at the front, it gaped at the front. And so when I attached my shell with just a string for a necklace, it actually pulled that in to be able to stop my boobs from falling out. So that's a little bit of a story behind the bikini top. Okay, now the little shell that we have here, I need to explain to you about the actual shell itself. So I'm going to take its things to bits, and I'm going to cut off my string so that I can actually show you. This is I found this on the beach while I was with my mum and my daughter last year, and it can be considered to be a button. As you can see, when you thread the yarn through it, which is a little bit fiddly, it has like these little points on it which make it so that when you hang the shell, it sits nicely. Okay, now just because I don't know actually how they made these little holes, that you know they were supposed to use different kinds of tools, but for the sake of my story, I actually have this tool. This tool is a staple extractor that I was given a long time ago, and it just happens just to fit into the actual shell. Okay, so somebody might say, oh well, you actually made it yourself. Well, I actually didn't, but I'm just saying it does actually fit, and it was just one of those things. It was just a little bit of a coincidence. Okay, so the story behind actually making these pieces to be able to make these triangles actually came because in my history research, I actually had managed to trace crochet all the way back to Egypt. And I'm going to share some documents. Well, they're not documents, there's some things I printed off the internet. So, and this particular one here, I can't actually show you an image of the actual hook, but this is actually printed off from the British Museum in England. And this is saying to you that there is a crochet needle, and it's a question mark because they're not quite sure. It's got its number, and it says it's a part of a wooden crochet needle with a hook at one end, and it's it says that its fine spot is pre-dynastic. Okay, so when it's pre-dynastic or pre-dynastic, I'm not quite sure how you pronounce that, then that means that it actually came from an era of approximately 3100 BC. And BC is, they used to say BC as before Christ and AD is after death, but BC is now become BCE, which is before current era, and you get CE, which is the current era. So I couldn't actually get an image of that, what I've done is I've got a different image. This is an image of a hook. This is actually listed as a fishing hook, and this is actually in the Boston Museum in America. Okay, but this is showing what is the, I know this is huge, but you can see the style of the work that they was doing at that time. And also in Egypt at that time, they was actually making beaded clothing. And all of this got me thinking, because I needed to have some actual proof to say like where crochet came from. And so, because I can go as far back as Egypt, and I actually have another artifact which I have to get up on to show you. This one, this is actually on the internet. I haven't printed off an image of this, And this image is of a pyramid that was found. This was actually found, I think it was found in America. And on the bottom of the pyramid, it has some strange symbols. Okay, and there's been a mystery about this pyramid for a long, long time. So while I was sitting there pretending to be my caveman, I decided, obviously with my bikini, that I'm on a Greek island where it's nice and warm. I actually translated the actual symbols into a crochet pattern. Okay, so I'm not saying that this is definitely right or definitely wrong. This is just something that I did for a bit of fun. Okay, so because I was trying to imagine, you know, being back there, I was thinking about the story of Homer and Penelope, which is all part of my research, and this just seemed to fit. Okay, so there's not really anything magical about this one. This, I mean, I could be completely wrong, but it actually works. Okay, so, and the way that it works is that at the top of the symbol of the pyramid, sorry, there is a symbol which curls to the left, which means follow the pattern around to the left. Okay, and so if I use the dots as a chain, I've got chain 5. Okay, I don't know if you can read my little translation down there. And the line going up is a slip stitch. The arrow to the left is to turn left. And the star is, as we know in our crochet patterns, that just means repeat. And the curved line going up was to represent chain 1. The arrow to the left is also turned to the left. And this, what looks like a hook or a letter J, is actually for a front post. And the cross over it is a single crochet in American terms, or a double crochet in English terms. And if I show you how to actually crochet that, I shall get my yarn. I'm using some cotton. This is the sugar and cream cotton, and my 5mm crochet hook. Okay, so I started off with quite a long tail end, about 30 inches, just because I wanted to, this is because what I wanted to use to be able to make the tie at the front, okay? And so what we do is we begin with a slip knot. And we do a chain of 5, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. We slip stitch into the first chain, and that makes us a chain 5 picot stitch. Okay, and then to carry on, we repeat as the pattern goes. So we chain 5, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. And slip stitch into the first chain. Okay, and we keep on doing this, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, to the desired length that we require. Okay, now if I go back to my actual drawing, on the image of the pyramid, there is actually 12 blocks at the bottom, which then go 11, 10, 9, 8, 7. Okay, so what I'm going to do is I'm going to show you with the blocks. So we've got to, so imagine that our picot stitches are these blocks. So we need to have a total of 12. Okay, so that's 3. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. Okay. And what we do is when we actually get to the 12, so I'm just going to pretend that we've actually got 12, okay? So we've actually got 4, I'll make it so we've got 5. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. Okay, oops, I've split my yarn. Never mind. So there, so imagine that we've got to our 12. And then the next stage is to chain 1, turn our work to the left, and a front post single crochet is actually when we go through something. So if we go through the loop there and we do a single crochet, or a double crochet if you're in England, we've latched onto that loop there. And then if we repeat the pattern again, we go 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. We slip stitch. But now we've got to bring into force the front post single crochet. So we have to do front post single crochet into the next one. Okay, I'm sorry, that looks a bit wonky. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. Slip stitch into the beginning and front post single crochet, or front post double crochet if you're in England, into the next one. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. Slip stitch into the first chain, front post single crochet, or single crochet into your chain of 5 loop. It really doesn't matter how you want to see that. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. And we slip stitch into there, and then we single crochet into the last one. And now we end up, instead of having our 5, we've now got 4. 1, 2, 3, 4. And if we do this correctly, like it said in the pattern, and we start off with 12 and we go all the way right down to the bottom, we end up with a triangle. And this triangle is actually a 60 degree angle triangle, which is actually the same angle as a genuine pyramid. And if you crochet a granny square for the bottom, you can actually make yourself a pyramid. Now, me personally, I obviously was imagining the towers are actually going to go on a Greek island, so I actually made mine into a bikini. But you can also have sandwiched two pieces together, okay, because I did find that it was a little bit see-through, and I'm quite shy like that, so I didn't want to be flashing anything. So we end up with two pieces. Now, this one, I'm just showing you how we finish at the end, because just so that you know if you're going to make your own, because I'm going to trust you with this one, because this video is actually an information video where I'm sharing some of my historical stuff, okay, and some of my treasures. So just to show you how to finish off, I did a chain one there, I turn, I single crochet or front post single crochet into there, I do a chain of 5, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, slip stitch into there and single crochet into this one, which makes you so that you've then got your top of your pyramid, okay, or top of your triangle. And then you need to just do one more chain and turn and do your last stitch, do a single crochet or a double crochet if you're in England, into that one there. And then what I did is I went back through this same hole here and into there, into my other triangle, and I single crocheted them together. And then I began the same sequence of doing the picot stitches. So that's 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, and slip stitch. And then when we look at our loops at the side, some of them are a little bit chunky because we've got that single crochet, and some of them are a bit looser. But what we do is we work through the two stitches as doing a single crochet, and this brings you, so you've got this frill that you're creating on the outside. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, slip stitch into there, oops, and this one's just a smaller variant of the loop, so we're single crocheting those together, okay, and you just join it all the way around. As you get to this point here, this is where you then change your style of work. So I'm just going to show you how this bit was done. If I undo this here, because there is a different way of turning your work. Okay, so what you do is you make yourself these pick a stitch chain. I did 27 on my green one, but on the pink one I actually decided to do 37 just because I preferred it that way. And you just need to take that chain one out. Okay, so if you make your chain, so you make yourself a chain of these picot stitches, picot, And then what you do is you turn your work to the left this way around and you slip stitch into underneath this one line there, and you create yourself another stitch. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. I've got tangled up there. Okay, and slip stitch to make your stitch, so you've got your picot stitch, and then you're going to slip stitch underneath the next one, and you just work yourself back down, and it creates you, this one's gone a bit folded I'm afraid, because when I was tying it up, but it creates this beautiful little, it's almost like a leaf actually, a bit like a dandelion leaf. Okay, so that's how I made my bikini, well, my bikini top. I haven't made the bottoms, because when I tried making the bottoms out of using this similar style, there was a little bit on the skimpy side, and I thought, oh, as much as it would be nice being on holiday like that, I still would, you know, I just like to have things covered up. I'm just, that's just the way I am. Okay, so I told you this is going to be a strange video. Okay, so now, because I used these rules of playing this game with the ancient pyramid, I decided to use the same sort of rules in my actual history research. Okay, so, oh, that's not the correct page I wanted to be on. Alright, so my next stage was, let me just get my, well, let's have a look. We go back through our history. Right, so this is it. This is my times in my Egyptian times. Okay. And then we then start to move, obviously, to closer to in England. And I've got King Henry VIII there. And the reason why I've chosen King Henry VIII is because King Henry VIII is supposedly wearing tights. And he also has a little tiny lace collar, which is... Queen Elizabeth, she wears a much bigger one. Okay, but we've got King Edward the Eighth, King Henry the Eighth there, sorry. And in the 1400s, there is actually an image of, this is supposed to be Madonna, and she's doing knitting with four needles on the round, and it says that she actually doesn't have a pattern, but there is a lady there laying down with a book, so she could be reading her the pattern. Okay, so it made me think, you know, it's like, so I thought, well, if they were crocheting in the 1400s, then surely there must be some kind of evidence other than these odd images here and there. And that's where I came across a manuscript. And the manuscript is called, I'm just turning my pages over. It's called the Voynich Manuscript. And here we go, here are images of the actual manuscript. And for years and years, this was made, it's been dated to be 1400, and, yeah, it says early 1400s anyway. I have the dates on the other page. And this shows you, these are the sorts of things that are in this manuscript, which is some kind of strange language that has never been translated, obviously since the 1400s, so that's over 600 years ago. And I'm going to show you something. You see, because in my tub of treasures, I have this. This is my lovely little tin. This is a Churchill's tin, which used of London, which had natural fruit sweets in it. However, inside my tin, I have a special lid. And the lid, I don't know if you can see, it's got a hole in it. And if I get my thread and thread it through the lid, yeah, I could sit and I could work away and my yarn would be coming out of its little packet and one long continuous thread. Okay, but I'll show you a trick. So I've got some paper. I'm sorry, I did say this is going to be a bit of a long-winded video, so you've got to bear with me. Right, then where's the little hole? Because it's like, there it is. Right, so what I'm going to do is I'm going to use my circle and I'm going to draw in my circle. Okay, so I've got a perfect circle. Now where this dot is, I'm just going to put a little line. Now if I use the lines of these shapes that I've got here and I line them up, what I can do is I can sit there and I can line that one up there, and where that hole is I can put another mark, and then I can line that line up to there and I can create myself another mark, and I can keep turning the dial like so, and I can create all these little lines all the way around. And I can also make these lines, I can use this differently. So instead of me using this straight line here, I can use this line here, and I can make myself different marks of measurements. Okay, so for the here, we've got 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8. Okay, so if I carry on going all the way around, I'm slightly off, so it will actually, I'll create 16 marks on my circle. Okay. Oh, that should be there. So they're approximately right, okay? And then if I use my, I've got learned tatting, okay? But if I use this as a ruler, that's why it's got written on it, ruler. Yeah, sorry, let's make a center point for my circle. Okay, now I can actually draw myself lines. Okay. Into my circle. I'll just do one more line there. And then if I go into my, I'm gonna put it back in my tin. I did. In my little tin of treasures, I have this, which is it's like for you to be able to use to be able to make, do embroidery with. However, if I use the circle out of the center of it, I can create myself another circle within my circle. Okay. Now, when you actually do written crochet patterns, what you would do is, if you're going to be working in a circle, you will actually draw something very similar to this. And so what you would do is you would put your, so if you're going to do a single crochet, you'd put a little cross in there. And that would be for my first round. My second round, I would then write into this one here. So if I wanted to do increase it, I would then put two crosses in each of my spaces, so that I know that I'm increasing. And obviously if I've got another one, I could actually make myself a third line there. But that is how you can actually write yourself crochet patterns. And so if we go back to the images of my manuscript, sorry, I was just doing my code. We see here, right, we have this circle with a flower in it. It has 8 points in this flower, okay? And so, and here, these could be representing, because they've got little stars in there, they could be representing to do increased stitches, or they could be representing to add beads onto your work. For example, there, okay? Now this would have been made, this is a perfect size circle, it's the same circle, look. Okay, there would have been, this sort of tool would have been used to have been made, to be able to make this. They would have worked out the measurements and worked out how many beads they wanted in each little section before they actually began doing the work. And the actual writing in the manuscript, I shall show you where is one. See if I can zoom in on it to show you. It's actually really awkward to see on this one. Let me just turn over to this page because I can show you better on this page. Sorry, it's taking time to load up. yeah, on this page here. tummy's rumbling now. If I zoom in on this page here, we can see here we have this symbol which is like this. Oh, no, that's a bit wrong. Do it again. It goes like this. Okay. You see, did you see me do that? Let me see me do that again and say that it goes like this, comes across, and like this. Okay, now that could be a slip stitch, or it could be a chain four and another stitch, so it could be chain five. It could be it could be anything to do with crochet, but it just to me does look very, very similar. Okay, so if I get my other work, because I've actually done some things on this, and so inside the written work there is actually there's lots of little circles which could represent a chain, and there is this symbol here. You do it like this, sort of like that. Now old-fashioned writing, as well, as I want to say, or ancient writing, like in the 1400s, the letter R was done, it joined on at the back of, instead of you drawing in, I mean, if I did an R, you used to join on at the back of the R here. So you do your letter C, and then you would join on there before doing the R. Okay, now obviously the R would then come back up. But for a lot of people, when they was writing really quickly, they didn't do that. They actually did the letter C and then they did the R in this sort of manner. Okay, so that could actually be a CR for crochet. Now, obviously, this could still be my active imagination. I'm not saying for sure. But the name of the manuscript is actually called the Voynich. Okay, now the Voynich manuscript is supposedly named after the man who discovered the actual book in, I think he discovered it in about 1912, I'm not 100% sure on that, but somewhere around about there. Okay, and he was a man from Poland and he collected books and he kept it until he died. However, there is actually, in all of the history that I've been doing and I've been looking at the writing, all of the royals, to be able to keep their secrets, they used to use things like anagrams and twisting things around. So if we twist this around, we still keep the letter V, okay, but we change this here, so we then get a C, H. We're going to use the O and put the I really close next to it, yeah, and then the Y and the A and the N, and it becomes a V chain. Okay, which could actually be a five chain, which is actually the same as not that page, which is actually the same as the pyramid, which is beginning with the chain five. Now, this still could be coincidental, and I could still be completely wrong. I'm not saying that I'm right, but I actually really do think that actually the Voynich manuscript is actually crochet patterns, and the designs that you can see would actually make you things like this. Okay, now carrying on with that same method of actually using the twists and turns of love, using anagrams, it leads me back to, I'm just going to show you actually, just show you some images that I've printed off, because in America, in the museum there, right, let's show you this first. In the Penelope magazine, which was the Dutch magazine, that was 1823, this is the star bottom bag that I've been looking for. And these are some other crochet bags that are actually in that magazine. And the magazine before that actually has these, which is netting and tatting. Okay, and with a very, very similar designs. So it makes it look like that they're from the same sort of person. Okay, So if we go over to Boston Museum, we can actually see they actually have this bag and these ones, this one, this one, and then there's this one. Now this one, which is all made of lots and lots of little tiny beads, is actually in the National Maritime Museum in England. And this is actually part of a find from the shipwreck of Benjamin Franklin, who set off in 1845. And if we look at these bags here, these are also in the National Maritime Museum. These bags was actually, or purses as they're known as, was actually supposed to belong to Lord Nelson. Okay, and Lord Nelson died in 1805, which predates all of these. Okay, and Lord Nelson, this is the ship that he would have been fighting in. When he had his battle, which was with Napoleon, that's Napoleon sulking because he lost the war. and this is the Rosetta Stone that was discovered at that time, which is, at the very top of it is hieroglyph, which is the Egyptian writing. It then moves on to Demotic script, and then it moves on to ancient Greek. Okay, so by using these and thinking about these, and thinking about all of my twists and my turns, I decided that I would go back to Mademoiselle Eleanor Rigo de la, I'm going to have to write it down here, Bronchardier. Okay? And in her work that was published in 1846. If I carry on going through my royal family and look through my royal family history, I can actually find this person. And this person is actually, she is not Mademoiselle. The reason why they put her as Miss is because if they'd have done as a Madame in French, Madame is actually, can actually be the owner of a brothel. So that actually can be turned into a prostitute. Okay. But a prostitute is also called a hooker, which is a giveaway. Eleanor is her first name. But because there was more than one Eleanor, they needed to give you a clue to who, which Eleanor it was. Rigo is Spanish for irrigation. Okay, so we've now got Eleanor, who's Spanish. So that's Eleanor of Castile. Okay, and Bronchardier, I love this one. It's so, so cool. Right, is actually E-R. Eleanor is the E. R is for Regina. So we've got R-E-G-I-N-A, which is Latin for queen. Okay. And Bronchardier, so if we carry on, actually we can change it into braid chain. And she actually, in the book where I was showing you before, where I showed you my little bag that I did, and I actually produced the A chain, which was A chain, where is it, where I crocheted two strands of yarn together. Let's see if I can do this. To give you a quick demonstration for those that haven't seen. I'm sorry, I've got all my work all tangled up, so let's just bear with me for this one. But let's just make myself a little slip knot there. I know this is all my work, but it doesn't matter. And put my hook onto there. And the A chain that she did, or but it actually is a braid chain, because it does say that in the actual pattern, okay, is where you do a chain with one and then you chain with the other, and then you chain with the top, and you chain with the bottom. Yeah, and you just keep on doing that action, which creates you, I mean, that's obviously quite messy, but it creates you a beautiful little chain if you do it properly, which I have actually used at the front of my tie, of my crochet bikini. And so, to work it out, so we've got Eleanor of Castile, who is, she's also a queen, which she was. She was actually a queen consort. And she was married to King Edward the First. Okay? And so, that is actually who Mama Zawigo is. And this actually proves this particular part of my actual work for sure. Proves that even though that we've got a French and Spanish mixture of things, that actually crochet was an English art. And I do believe that what was happening is that they was actually using the story of Homer. And Homer tells you the story of Penelope and Ulysses. And Penelope and Ulysses were... They lived, you'll know of Ulysses because he was actually one of the, he went into the war of the Trojan War, and he was one of the ones that went inside the actual hollowed out horse. Okay, so so that's how they got into there. And Penelope, she stayed at home, and she stayed there for 20 years waiting for him. And it's quite possible that they believe that Penelope actually did make the actual crochet in the very, very beginning. And it was then passed on through the royals. So, and eventually, because obviously in England, we didn't even have any, our first king and queen wasn't until 700 and something. So, and what actually happened was, just I'll draw you a little map. This is going to be my rough England. That's England and that's Ireland. Okay, and we've got France over here, and Spain drops down. This is Africa down there, and we've got what have we got? We've got that's supposed to be a boot, isn't it, for Italy? Okay, and we come along and we join over. That's part of Greece there, and here, say of Africa, about here is the River Nile, and over here, sort of somewhere around about there, this is a bit slightly wonky, is Ithaca. Okay, so what happened was is that Penelope was on Ithaca and she crocheted. It went over to Greece and then made its way through France and over to England that way around. And as we did our history, as the kings and queens and everything was doing their tracing back, that's how they ended up going back, and you end up going back to Ithaca. And if we actually look at our very first item that I've actually got of crochet, which is actually a wooden hook, which is actually found around about here, it might be the other side of the Nile, but somewhere around about with the Nile, which means it could have floated from Ithaca over to Egypt. Now, I'm not saying that it definitely did, because obviously that's even, that means that this is story is a lot, lot older, because Homer's story was written in 800 BC. So, and the hawk is dated before that. And obviously we've got things, we've got items that we've got that are dated prior to that, that could also be crochet. So I can't prove that that is the actual origins, but I can actually prove that through the royal lineage, it actually was, it became right from 800, actually was an English art, okay, that was actually probably done quite secretly or as a game maybe, so that they'd got to try and invent new stitches, okay, so that, and that's how that they progressed, because at the end of the day, they didn't have any televisions, they didn't have any other things, and They'd learned things like crocheting with beads. These are done with some little wooden beads which are made out of balsa wood, which will float. And also these, I've got these up as well. I've got these beautiful little elephants. These are also made out of wood, which I think is balsa wood. And these could have actually have even been bath toys, I suppose, at one time. But they quite possibly also are crochet patterns. And so you begin with your magic loop, and then you can make your chains into your circle and then follow them, and you can create yourself little flowers if you follow the patterns on there. And also, because of the entertainment value of things, I also have these beautiful, I don't know, because I'm really not sure whether these are actually what they're made out of. These are beautiful stones that I crocheted. It's like they've got the tiniest little hole in it, so I could only use this tiny, tiny thread. And obviously, I didn't do a very good job because, look, some of them are hanging a bit far from the others. But they're like little stones. And where's my other thing? Because it's, I don't know, it's like this. Is this here, look? I've got this little tiny thing. It's like a little tiny seed, which I found inside this shell. Okay, because I was actually trying to make a hole in the top so I could actually make myself like a little pendant out of it. And it had little things stuck inside it. And so I don't know what it is. It doesn't, you can kind of write with it a little bit. So it could even be an ancient writing tool for all I know. But I think it might be a seed. But so looking at history, I've got all these strange little things. And I've made up what could possibly be just be a made up story. But when it comes to actually making this, I really, really do think that I'm actually right. I do think that Mademoiselle Rigo de la Branchardière is actually Eleanor of Castile, which was the Queen Consort, and she was married to King Edward. And if we look on the internet, just to add that little bit of oomph to this, let me see, let's get King Edward up. Come here, King Edward. Here we go. I've got an image, look, of King Edward. And on King Edward's image, we've got things like this E, and we've got this little 9 there, which might not be a 9, because if we look at the manuscript, we can actually see that that same sort of 9 is there, and we've got these strange little loops. And if I get, where's my other image? I have another image, she says, that I've lost it. What did I do with the image? Oh, here it is. There, look, if you look, this is Mademoiselle Rigo's bell gauge, okay, but it's there, we've got, this is H. Walker's needles, and this swirls of writing is very, very similar in here as well. So to me, I do believe that this is showing you that this is how it was actually. I don't know, I'm not sure whether it was just a game that they used to play, and it's like, let's see if we can, how many stitches can we invent with this, or whether like the Homer story was the thing, so that you can try and find your way back home to find your origins of where you came from, and to find out that actually everybody from England began from Ithaca, maybe. I don't know. But what I do know is that I have discovered something, and I do believe that crochet is definitely a royal art. And the reason why they couldn't actually say that it was actually the royals, and they've had to share it this way, is because when you look at things like this, look, let me just show you this little hook. Okay, this little hook here has got, I don't know if you can see this, it has a picture of a crown on it, and it has trademark. Yeah, and I think that because the royal family weren't allowed to actually trait, you know, like to say, oh, I've invented this. Yeah, they had to just sort of do it secretly. So they sort of let things go out into the market and let other people use them. And a lot of the time it was actually through fabric and through clothing. So you would have wore the necklaces so that you was actually chain, you know, so that you actually got crochet. Yeah, and so these things would have been around just so that they actually belonged in the royal family for a long time. And they would have hidden their things. I mean, it's like this. This is actually made from, I know it's got some kind of strange plastic on the back. Do you know, that reminds me of like Bakelite that they used to make telephones out of. But it's actually one of these shells that has been broken into like tiny pieces and then made into triangles and then perfectly placed on there to be able to, and you can make all sorts of different dials with this. You know, so if like for loads of different circle patterns. So, and also King Edward the First, I just have to say, because this is my Conway Castle. I've got all my little bits, you see, just to say, because King Edward the First, he actually built Conway Castle, and I love Conway Castle. It's one of my most favourite places, which I collected something really magical from the outside of that castle once. And so... Oh, what have I got here? I've just got my thimble. I think that I've actually shared all my important things that I wanted to share with you. Okay, as in, I know it's sort of a jumbled up story because I've never been able to try and find the right words for this. It's took me a long, long time. And like I said, I've babbled on now for 46 minutes. But hopefully, I've actually proven that crochet is an English art that belong to our royal family, and for whatever, there seems to be something, you know, there's like, it's almost like that they've been, they've not been allowed to tell us all about it, and maybe that is because of the patenting laws, because we have to go to our royals to get the royal stamp if we pay. So if I invented something, I have to send it off to the patent office, and the patent office has to get like the Queen's permission, like stamp that to say nobody's invented that before. And so I think that actually that crochet was actually, say, it's been a royal thing, and they've invented new stitches over the years, and they've kept it as well, like one of the biggest secrets, really throughout history. And maybe, you know, like some of the wars that we had, you know, like with Napoleon and things like that, maybe that was because they was all trying to fight it so that they could actually pinch the secret of the royals, but they didn't realize that the secret was actually crochet, and they thought it was some kind of I don't know, heat-seeking missile or something something bizarre, I don't know. But the thing is that I'm not quite sure that I've told it right. I hope I have. I hope that you gives you something to think about anyway. Okay, so thank you for watching, thank you for liking, thank you for sharing, thank you for subscribing, and bye for now.